نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربنا زدنا علما Inshallah we'll begin from page number 32 Number 21 إثبات الكلام لله تعالى إثبات affirmation of Al-Kalam, speech, lillahi, for Allah Ta'ala, He is high and exalted. Meaning the fact that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala has the attribute of speech, meaning He speaks. He speaks. So, when Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala sent the Qur'an is Allah's speech, His word. So, in this topic, basically we will cover two things. First of all, the attribute of speech. And secondly, the fact that the Qur'an is Allah's speech and not His creation. وَقَوْلِهِ and His statement, وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حَدِيثًا And who is more truthful than Allah in hadith? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself says that He is the most truthful in hadith. What is hadith? Speech. A statement. Meaning Allah's statement is the most correct, it is the most true, it is far from any falsehood, from any error. وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حَدِيثًا وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا And who is more truthful than Allah in قِيل? قِيل, قَوْل, what does it mean? Speech, meaning words. So Allah's words are the most truthful, they are the most correct. So from both of these verses, what do we learn? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says words, He says statements. So speech is affirmed for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ And when Allah said, يَا عِيسَى وَعِيسَى إِبْنَ مَرْيَمْ Son of Maryam. So the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, إِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ When Allah said, on the day of judgment also, Allah will say. So again, what does this prove? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks. And notice over here, Ya Isa, O Isa. What does this imply? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will speak to Isa alayhi salam directly on the Day of Judgment, right? And Ya Isa, O Isa. He's calling him, he's addressing him directly. Which means that Isa alayhi salam is being addressed. Which means that he can hear the words of Allah. So what does it mean? That the speech of Allah is with what? With words. Speech that is audible. That can be heard by the one for whom the speech is directed. وَتَمَّتْ And it was complete. كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكْ The word of your Lord, صِدْقًا In truth, وَعَدْلًا And in justice. The word of your Lord has been fulfilled in truth as well as in justice. Meaning whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it will come true. It will always be according to reality. And adla, justice, meaning it will also be always, always fair. His words are always just. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's speech, it is free of lies, it is free of falsehood, it is free of any injustice, any kind of oppression. وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا And Allah spoke to Musa a taklim. Taklim is masdar. And why is this being said at the end of the ayah? Taklim, to emphasize that it was proper speech. It was what you call speech. So this means that Musa alayhi salam, he was spoken to by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed him directly. So Musa alayhi salam heard the words of Allah. So taklim, it was a complete kalam. Because you will never call kalam a conversation in which you cannot hear the other. Right? You don't know what they're saying. So, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا مِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَلَّمَ اللَّهُ Among them are those whom Allah spoke to. Meaning, among the messengers are those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly spoke to. وَلَمَّا جَاءَ مُوسَى لِمِيقَاتِنَا And when Musa alayhi salam came for our meeting, for our appointment, وَكَلَّمَهُ رَبُّهُ And his Lord spoke to him. Meaning he spoke to him, as speech is done. وَنَادَيْنَاهُ And we called him, مِنْ جَانِبِ الطُّورِ الْأَيْمَنِ From the right side of the Tur, the Mount Tur, وَقَرَّبْنَاهُ نَجِيًّا and we drew him near in private conversation. Meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conversed with Musa alayhi salam privately. Musa alayhi salam heard those words, heard Allah's speech, but he was the only one who heard them. You understand? Meaning, even if there was somebody nearby, there wasn't, but even if there was anybody nearby, they wouldn't be able to hear those words. Why? Because that speech was directed to who? Only Musa alayhi salam. وَقَرَّبْنَاهُ نَجِيًّا. Now notice over here, in all of these verses, what is being mentioned again and again? How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Musa alayhi salam. Right? Now, the first ayah which is mentioned, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. You remember how the Ahlul Tahrif, the people of Tahrif, what they did with this ayah? They changed the ayah, right? What did they do? كَلَّمَ اللَّهَ مُوسَى. That Musa spoke to Allah. Because they did not believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can speak. So they changed the ayah. But it's amazing how Shaykhul Islam brings one ayah after the other, right? Specific to who? Musa alayhi salam, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking to Musa alayhi salam directly, that which ayah now will you deny? Which ayah now will you distort? You cannot. Okay, if you distort وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا, how can you distort وَلَمَّا جَاءَ مُوسَى لِمِيقَاتِنَا وَكَلَّمَهُ رَبُّهُ? How can you distort that? Likewise, وَنَادَيْنَاهُ, we called him. Can this be changed? No. So which ayah can be denied? Which ayah can be altered? وَإِذْ نَادَى رَبُّكَ, and when your Lord called out to who? Musa, Musa alayhi salam, أَنِئْتِ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ, that go to the wrongdoing people. Meaning go to Fir'aun and his people. Musa alayhi salam was spoken to by Allah. وَنَادَاهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا, and their Lord called out to both of them. أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا, did I not forbid both of you عَنْ تِلْكُمَ الشَّجَرَةِ, from this tree? So this kalam was directed to who? Adam alayhi salam. So what does this ayah teach us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also spoke to Adam alayhi salam. In a hadith which is authentic, in as-Salsilatu sahihah, we learn that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam and blew the ruh into him, the ruh, when it reached his nose, Adam alayhi salam, he sneezed. And the first words that Adam alayhi salam said were, Alhamdulillah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, Yarhamukallah. May Allah have mercy on you. So again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Adam alayhi salam also. Not just once, but multiple times. وَيَوْمَ يُنَادِيهِمْ, and the day when he will call them. Them, meaning who? People. فَيَقُولُ, then he will say, مَاذَا أَجَبْتُمُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, what is it that you responded to the messengers? Meaning, how did you respond to the call of the prophets that were sent to you? So what do we learn in this ayah? That Allah will speak to people. Right? The ummas, the different nations on the day of judgment. Because he will call them to account. He will ask them, what did your messengers convey to you? And what did you do in return to the messengers? How did you respond to them? In a hadith also we learn, the Prophet ﷺ said, مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا وَسَيُكَلِّمُهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. There is none amongst you except that Allah will speak to you on the day of judgment. And obviously this is referring to who? Those who believe, because there are those people whom لا يكلمهم الله. Allah will not speak to them. Allah will not look at them. Allah will not purify them. But those who do believe, those who do worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will definitely speak to them on the day of judgment. And this is a fact about Allah. Allah speaks. He is ilah, he is Rabb, he is our God. We ask him and he responds. When we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we recite Surah Al-Fatiha also, Allah responds. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ. What is response? Through speech. Right? It is always through speech. So, who does not speak? Who does not speak? Think about it. Who cannot speak? Inanimate objects, right? Such as idols, statues, they do not speak. But our Lord Allah, He speaks. He hears and He answers. And this is what establishes the beautiful connection between the master and his servant. Communication. Communication. Because think about it. If you are speaking to somebody and there is no answer, how does that feel? You're talking and there is no response. The other is silent. They are quiet. They're unresponsive. It's not a good feeling at all. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks. And notice how, you know, when a person speaks to Allah, meaning he makes dua, then Allah is as-Samir, He is al-Mujib. He responds. Even, you know, this is something so amazing. You recite Surah Al-Fatiha 4 times in every prayer. And each time you pray, you recite Surah Al-Fatiha, Allah answers you. It's a meeting with Allah. This is why when Musa alayhi salam went to the Tur, what is that called? Miqat, appointment. It was an appointment. Come speak to your Lord and your Lord will speak to you. He will guide you. He will tell you what to do. He will give you direction. And what was Musa alayhi salam given over there? The Torah, right? So this is the communication between the master and his servant, right? And think about it. Any person who is, you know, very honorable or very important, what do you want? You want to speak to them, right? And how much you try to get even a few minutes with them, isn't it? You call in advance. You speak to their, you know, assistant or whoever. You try to get 5 minutes from them, 10 minutes from them, 15 minutes from them. Right? You just want to be able to speak to them directly. But even in that conversation, you know, you feel afraid, you feel rushed. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest of those who are great. Allahu Akbar. The one who knows you the most, the one who loves you the most, the one who understands you the most. He speaks to you. If you speak to him, you respond to his call today, Allah will speak to you also. And it's also amazing that you know, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can do this, that so many people are speaking to Him. And He hears all of them. He listens to all of them. He responds to every single one of them. And it's amazing how sometimes your wish or your concern or your question is still in your heart. You haven't been able to even express it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He responds to that. Now remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's speech, it is kalam that is haqiqi, that is real. Alright? It is real speech. It is speech that is in reality. And He speaks whenever He wills and however He wills, as He wills. Whenever He wills, meaning He doesn't need anybody's permission. However He wills. He can give a command, He can give a prohibition, He can give good news, He can give warning. It's up to Him, however He wills. As He wills. And His speech is with words, with huruf, with kalimat. And with a voice that is audible. Because if it was not with a voice, then how would Musa alayhi salam hear his Lord? You understand? How would he? He wouldn't be able to. Now the following verses are about the Quran. The evidence that Quran is also the speech of Allah. The verses that we learned so far, they're in general about the attribute of speech. Now the following verses are specifically about the Quran. That the Quran is also the speech of Allah. It is not a creation. وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ And if anyone amongst the idolaters, استجارك, he seeks your protection. فَأَجِرْهُ Then give him protection. حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ Until he hears the speech of Allah. You remember the context of this ayah? Surah At-Tawbah. Right? That when the mushrikeen were given 4 months grace period, that in this time, either you believe, accept Islam, leave your idolatry, or if you don't wish to, then you have to leave the Arabian Peninsula. Right? So what was said that after those months are passed, they're over, if any mushrik says, I need some more time, then somebody has to give him protection. Meaning a Muslim has to give him protection. So give him protection. حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ Until he can hear the word of Allah. Meaning he can hear the Quran. He can learn the Quran. He can come to know about what the Quran says. So what is Kalam Allah over here? The Quran. So remember that the Quran is Allah's speech. Now many times we say things like, Allah is the author of the Quran. No, we don't say that He is the author. Remember that human beings are authors. Being an author of a book means that you have written a draft and you have researched. And you have found errors, and you have fixed them, and you have reviewed it, and you have asked others to review it. Being an author instantly implies what? Your weakness. your limited knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke the Qur'an. He said the Qur'an. You understand? So the Qur'an is kalam Allah. The next ayah, وَقَدْ كَانَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ. And a group among them. Among who? The people of the book. يَسْمَعُونَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. They hear the speech of Allah. And after hearing it, ثُمَّ يُحَرِّفُونَهُ. Then they alter it, they distort it. مِن بَعْدِ مَا عَقَلُوهُ. After they have understood it. وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. While they know. So over here, what is being mentioned? How the people of the book, they would hear the words of revelation, the Torah. And what would they do after that? Distort the words. They would change the words. While they knew the correct meaning, what would they do? They would still distort it. So again, kalam Allah. What is kalam Allah? The Torah. What is that? The book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent. Right? And obviously, the same applies to the Quran. The next ayah, يُرِيدُونَ أَن يُبَدِّلُوا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. They wish to change the words of Allah. The words of Allah, what does that refer to? The Qur'an. This ayah is basically about the munafiqeen. That how when they did not participate in certain expeditions, they were told that from now on, you cannot participate in any expedition with the Prophet ﷺ. You stayed behind this time, now you always must stay behind. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned the believers that next time that you will go, what will happen? They will come and they will say, we want to come along with you, because they see, you know, some expected benefit, booty, victory. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُرِيدُونَ أَن يُبَدِّلُوا كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. They wish to change the words of Allah. Allah said, they shall not accompany you. And now they want to contradict that by accompanying you. So kalam Allah refers to what? The verses in the Qur'an. So again, the speech of Allah, meaning the Qur'an. قُلْ لَن تَتَّبِعُونَ. Say, never will you follow us, meaning never will you come along with us. كَذَلِكُمْ قَالَ اللَّهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said before, meaning this is what He instructed concerning you, that you shall not be allowed to accompany the believers again. The next ayah, وَاتْلُ مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ كِتَابِ رَبِّكَ. And recite what has been revealed to you from the book of your Lord. لَا مُبَدِّلَ لِكَلِمَاتِهِ. There is none who can change his words. Which words? The Qur'an. The next ayah, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. Indeed, this Qur'an, يَقُصُّ عَلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ أَكْثَرَ الَّذِي هُمْ فِيهِ يَخْتَلِفُونَ. يَقُصُّ, it narrates, عَلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ, to the Bani Israel, أَكْثَرَ, most of that in which they used to differ. Meaning the differences, the disputes that they had, the Qur'an clarifies them. But notice the word over here, يَقُصُّ. It narrates, it relates, it's a narration. And narration is always how? In speech, right? And if it's in a written form, it's because that speech was recorded. It was written down. Storytelling. Storytelling. That means a story is told. It is spoken. It is said. Correct? And then eventually they are recorded and they're written down. Now, notice how in the ayah before, وَاتْلُ مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ كِتَابِ رَبِّكَ, the Qur'an is also called kitab. Now, when we think of a kitab, we think of something physical, right? And something that is physical, I mean, it's makhluq, it's creation. So then how do we reconcile this? Qur'an is called kalam of Allah, and it's also called kitab. So is it makhluq, is it a creation, or is it Allah's speech? What is it? Remember that kitab, book, the way we understand kitab as book, this is not how it was always understood before. When the Qur'an was being revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, was it given in a book form? Did it even exist in a book form during the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ? No. It was recorded, but where? Leaves, barks, parchment, leather, right? So on and so forth. And then eventually, what happened? It was recorded in a book form, mushaf, right? Of Hafsa radiallahu anha. Remember? So that came much later. During the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ, there was no kitab as in a physical form. Kitab literally means, it's from katb. And what does katb mean? Jammer. It means, kataba means to write, to record, but katb also means jammer, to collect, to gather together. So the reason why it's called kitab is because in it, you know, many, basically it's a collection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's speech. Right? His messages that he sent to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, why is it that we are, you know, going into this? Why is it that, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah has dedicated an entire topic to this, that the Qur'an is the kalam of Allah? Don't we already believe in that? We already believe in that, alhamdulillah. But remember that many disagreements occurred surrounding this issue between the Ahlus Sunnah and some other schools of thought, such as the Mu'tazila, right? And this created a lot of, you can say, division in the Ummah, as well as at the time when this controversy began, there was a lot of fitna that resulted because of this controversy. And that fitna, obviously, it converted into great persecution of the scholars of Ahlus Sunnah. And they stood firm on this belief that no, Qur'an is not a creation. It is, in fact, the speech of Allah. Now remember that Khalifa Ma'mun, he was convinced by the Mu'tazili scholars that the Qur'an is the makhluq. And you know how sometimes it happens that if you believe in something, and then you want others to agree with you. You say something and you want others to agree with you. Many times it happens that you accept the difference of opinion. That, okay, you know, you believe what you believe in and I believe in what I believe in. Live and let live. We agree to disagree. But this became a matter of pride for this Khalifa, and he did not tolerate any scholar saying that the Quran was the speech of Allah. He demanded from every scholar that every scholar must say the Quran is the creation of Allah. And he threatened that if anyone does not comply, they will be killed. They will be assassinated. So what happened? Majority of the scholars, they said what Ma'mun wanted them to say. Even though they did not believe in that, they said it. Why? Because they said, we have an excuse here. This is a matter, you know, in which we are being coerced, we are being forced. And if you can say a kalima of kufr to save your life, you know that, right? A person can even say a kalima of kufr to save his life. Then why can we not say a kalima of, not kufr, but something less than that to save our life? You understand? So this is the reasoning that they had. And some other scholars, what they did was that they showed to Ma'mun that they were saying the Quran is a makhluk, but they didn't actually mean it. So for example, they said, the Torah, the Injil, the Quran, these are the creation of Allah. You understood from my action that they counted on their fingers. Torah, Injil, Quran. These. Now, when they said these, they didn't mean in their hearts, in their minds, Quran, Torah, Injil. They meant fingers. These, meaning my fingers, are the creation of Allah. You understand? So they did this to save their lives. And at the same time, they did not want to say, you know, that they believed that the Quran was a creation, but at the same time, they had to save their lives somehow. Now, two scholars, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Muhammad ibn Nuh, they refused to listen to Ma'mun. And they said, the Quran is speech, it is not created. And they said this very boldly, very confidently. And they knew exactly what was going to come. And they said that they didn't have an excuse to say anything otherwise, because when you're allowed to say a kalima of kufr to save your life, that's when it's because of a personal reason. And they said this is not a personal reason. This is a matter of the sharia. If an ordinary person says, okay, Quran is makhluk, whatever, in my heart I believe it is kalam. If an ordinary person says that, no big deal. But when a scholar will say that, you understand, it will have different implications. So they said, this is not a personal matter. This is an issue about the preservation of the deen, of the sharia. And when you have to preserve the deen, then even if your life is at risk, it doesn't matter. Then in this situation, what is necessary? Jihad. Just like the sahaba, for the protection, for the preservation of the deen, they put their necks forward. Right? They put their lives at risk to preserve the deen. They could have said, no, you know what? We're just going to stay at home. You don't really have to give up your life, you know. But Imam Ahmad and Muhammad ibn Nuh, they stood firm. Muhammad ibn Nuh, he was assassinated. He was killed. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he was tortured and he was persecuted. But he did not give up. He insisted, he debated, he argued, he was imprisoned, he was physically beaten, he was publicly humiliated, but he did not give up. And you know what? The whole ummah was with him. Because people only said Quran was makhluq out of fear of Ma'mun. Right? But when they saw Imam Ahmad, a great giant, really standing so firm in this time of trial, they supported him. So this is why the scholars say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserved Islam through Abu Bakr during the days of Riddah, during the days of apostasy, and through Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal during the days of Mihna, meaning the great trial, the great test. Because if Imam Ahmad did not stand firm at this, then what would happen? Majority of the people would be Mu'tazili. They would believe that the Quran is created. Now, what's the big deal? Why does it really matter if a person believes that the Quran is created or it is not created? Does it really make much of a difference? What's the big deal over here? You know, for us, we think, oh, it's no big deal. But to believe that the Quran is creation, that has many implications. If a person says Quran is creation, then you know what he's implying? First of all, he's rejecting parts of the Quran. Because Allah himself says, Kalam Allah, Kalam Allah, Kalam Allah. Isn't it? So when Allah himself says the Quran is his speech, and we say Quran is makhluq, then who are we contradicting? Allah's statement, right? We are contradicting that. We are opposing that. Secondly, if we say that Quran is creation, think about it. Would the Quran hold the same value? The same, you know, sacredness and sanctity? Would it? You know, then a person would say, yeah, okay, Quran is creation, this table is creation, you are creation, I am creation, we are all creation. The Quran, if it has value, if it is important to us, if we consider it holy, why is that so? Because it is Allah's speech. One ayah from the Quran is enough as evidence. Why? Because it is from Allah. It is His speech. And the statement of another person, what does that matter? You understand? The Quran would lose its value, its supremacy, if we were to say that it is a creation. Because you see, creation is subject to change. Isn't it? You can change it. Like, for example, if there is a table, it's brown, you can paint it black. You can paint it white. You can change it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us that ability. He has given us that liberty even, right? That we can change the creation in the sense that, not the kind of, changing that is from shaitan, but changing in the sense that fashioning it in a way that suits us. There is a piece of wood. You can change that big log into a table. Can you do that? Yes, because that suits you better, that serves you better, that is of more use to you. Creation is subject to change. It can be changed, it can be altered, it can be negated, it can be refuted. And if we treated the Quran like any other creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what would that mean? To change it. And this is the reason why we see that people who believe that the Quran is created, they are the ones who delved into tahrif. They're the ones who did not respect the Quran. Think about it. How can a person have the guts to change the words of Allah? وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. If this is how it has been recited always, a person changing the huruf, what gives them the confidence to do that? Because they don't have that much respect for the Quran. Why don't they have that respect for the Quran? Because they don't believe it's the speech of Allah. They think it's a creation. They can change the words, istawa to istawla. They can say things like, ya rahim, rahman, quddus, as-Salām. It's all the same. It's just a difference of huruf. You see how all of these problems began? You see how all of this began? From where? From this corrupt belief. From not giving the haqq of the Quran. Not respecting the Quran. Not treating it as kalam of Allah, rather treating it as if it was an ordinary creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, if a person says the Quran is makhluq, then he's implying that every attribute of Allah is makhluq. How? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has clearly said, Kalam Allah. If a person says Kalam, you know, when a person speaks, you know, when someone speaks, then that is makhluq. Then you're saying, okay, his rahmah is makhluq, and his adl is makhluq, and his ghadab is makhluq. Basically, what is a person saying then? That there is no difference between the creator and the creation. You understand? Then a person loses respect for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also. And this is the reason why people have dared to say things about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which when we hear, we shudder. How could a person even think like that? How could a person even say something like that? So it all begins with the corruption of this belief. And this is the reason why Imam Ahmad, he stood so firmly on this, that the Quran is not makhluq, it is kalam. Treat it as Allah's kalam. And the thing is that speech, when we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he spoke the Quran is his speech, it has a lot of value. Because any speech, when does it have importance and value? When? Because of who has said it. You understand? Sometimes it happens that the same thing is being said by two people. Two people are saying the exact same words, but you tend to listen to one person more. Why? Why? Because they're more important to you. Your mother tells you something and your husband tells you the same thing. Now the one whom you love more, you listen to them. Right? So, the Quran is Allah's speech. It has value because it is Allah's kalam. And remember that his kalam is different from his makhluq. Because Allah says in the Quran, أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ. خَلْق and أَمْر. Both are mentioned separately. A distinction has been made between creation and command. Allah's command is what? The command that He gave, that He spoke. So for example, the Quran. So the Quran is not makhluq. You cannot mix this up. You have to maintain this difference that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself has taught us. Khalq is one thing and amr is something else. Clear? So you understand why this is a big deal? Okay, anything you'd like to say before we continue? That the creation, what happens to it over time? It loses its importance, its value, right? For example, a person, when they're alive, when they're working, they have a lot of importance. They have a lot of value, but when they die, 100 years later, 200 years later, who knows them? Who remembers them? Hardly anybody. Maybe their name is mentioned somewhere, but hardly anybody. Right? But the Quran is Allah's speech. With the passage of time, it is still relevant, it is still important, it still must be respected, and it still must be followed. Okay, why is it that the Mu'tazili did not accept that the Quran is Kalam of Allah? Because they did not believe in the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see, the people of Ta'til, what is their problem? The main problem is they don't want to accept Allah's attributes. Because they say if you believe that Allah speaks, He has mercy, He hears, He sees, then you are resembling Him to the creation.
I'm saying that this one corrupt belief that people had, or assumed that they were right, has dissolved in their eyes, for them, the whole structure of Islam. The values and the respect of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His izzah and His, all His attributes, everything is kind of like, you know, just you pull one brick,
yes,
and the whole building falls. So how important it is to believe even the correct way.
Yes.
And that's what I find when I'm coming here. You think that you know everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one, and you know. But living in this age and today and here, it's so important to know the correct value, the correct belief, and how to enact it, and how to defend it even.
Yeah, very true. Now, remember that when the Muslims interacted with other nations, other people, they came across obviously different religions, and also different ideologies, and the people of philosophy, right? When their writings were translated into Arabic, just like people do today, they wanted to include that as part of Islam. Because philosophy, you know, was the in thing. So they wanted to show that Quran, Islam does not contradict philosophy. You understand? And in order to make that acceptable within Islam, they came up with evidences from the Quran and they changed basically the deen. And that's exactly what happens today. You know, whatever is the in thing, whatever people believe in or what the masses want you to do, you try to incorporate that within the religion. But Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they remain firm upon the deen. لا يخافون لومة لائم. You understand? And this is the reason why aqeedah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, you know, it came into being. Because at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were no terms such as tawheed is of three categories, uluhiyah, rububiyah, asma' wa sifat. You don't find these terms in hadith. Do you come across terms such as ta'til, tahrif, ta'wil? You don't come across these terms, right? So they were developed later on by the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah in order to defend the religion. You understand?
About the changing of the deen, how people have done that. We actually do not need to do that, and we can still be inclusive. And in those days, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that I'm sent for the red and the black and the white and the brown and everybody. And at that time, everybody was included and Islam prevailed. So we really do not need to do any such thing. The Christians incorporated the rituals of the people who already existed here about the tree and the Christmas tree. If you ask them, they really don't know.
Imitating other nations, right? So that's exactly what some Muslims started doing.
Assalamu alaikum. I was thinking how important it is for every one of us to continue to purify this aqeedah, this aspect of kalamullah. Subhanallah, it is only because of this issue with our aqeedah that we don't consider the kalam of Allah as the kalam of Allah. Whether that kalam is in our phones these days, you know, it's not in the book form, always now in our gadgets, or if it is in a book form, we don't
respect it. We don't give it its haqq. And what you mentioned about, you know, taking an oath by the Qur'an, swearing an oath by the Qur'an, remember that because Qur'an is Allah's kalam, it is His sifa, it is from Him, to Him it will return, okay? This is why it is correct to swear an oath by the Qur'an. But you better swear an oath that is correct. Because, you know, when a person lies, you know, placing their hand on the Qur'an, yes, I swear such and such and such and such, why is it that they're not being honest? Because they think, oh, Quran is only a book. It's a book. But if we understood that this is Allah's speech, this is His attribute, it has come from Him, it is His, then we would never dare lie while placing our hand on the Quran. Now, the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the belief is concerning the Quran, that it is Kalamullah, it is a speech of Allah, it is Munazzal, it has been revealed. It is غير مخلوق. It is not creation. منه بدأ. From Him it came. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who said the Quran. بدأ. بدأ is what? Initiation. So He initiated it, meaning He said it. وإليه يعود. And to Him it will return. Because you know that towards the end of time, when the only people that will remain are the most corrupt, then what will happen? The Quran will be taken away. It will be lifted up. So, وَإِلَيْهِ يَعُودُ. Number 22. إِثْبَاتُ affirmation of تَنْزِيلِ الْقُرْآنِ revelation of the Quran من الله تعالى from Allah the Exalted. The fact that the Quran has been revealed by Allah. It was sent down by Allah. So first of all, we believe that it is a speech. And secondly, we believe that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is Al-Ali, the highest one, He sent the Qur'an down. He spoke it. He sent it. And through who? Through Jibreel. In a hadith we learn, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that you can never return to Allah, meaning draw close to Him, with anything better than that which has come from Him. Yani, Al-Quran. So if you want to draw close to Allah, then you better hold on to that which has come from Him. And what is that? Hablullah al-Mateen, the Quran. He sent it down. وقوله, and his statement, وَهَذَا كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ, and this is a book. أَنزَلْنَاهُ, we have revealed it. We have sent it down. مُبَارَكٌ, it is full of barakah. Notice, أَنزَلْنَاهُ, not خَلَقْنَاهُ. We sent it down, not that we created it, because it is a speech. The next ayah, لَوْ أَنزَلْنَا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ عَلَى جَبَلٍ لَرَأَيْتَهُ خَاشِعًا مُتَصَدِّعًا مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ. If we had sent down this Quran upon a mountain, surely you would see that mountain خَاشِعًا, fearful, humbling, مُتَصَدِّعًا, shattering, breaking apart, مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ, out of the fear of Allah. Now in this ayah, what is mentioned? A mountain. And if you think about it, on this earth, one of the biggest creations is what? Mountains. They're tallest, right? They're so tall, they're so huge, they're so heavy. And yet, a mountain does not have the capacity to bear the Quran. Bear the weight of the Quran. Now, if you place a Quran on a mountain, would the mountain shatter? Meaning a physical book, the Mus'haf? No. So what does it mean then? The Quran is not makhluq. Because if it was makhluq, then the mountain can for sure bear the weight of the Mus'haf. Can it not? It can. In fact, it can bear the weight of many heavy things. So many trees, so many buildings, so many people, so many huge boulders. It can bear that weight. If the Quran was makhluq, the mountain could have surely carried it easily. But the Quran is not makhluq. It is Allah's speech. And this is the reason why even a mountain could not carry the weight of the Quran. If the Quran was sent upon a mountain, that mountain would shatter from the fear of Allah. Next ayah, وَإِذَا بَدَّلْنَا آيَةً, when we change an ayah, مَكَانَ آيَةٍ, in the place of an ayah, meaning we substitute a verse in place of a verse. And this is referring to نَسْخ, right? وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا يُنَزِّلْ, and Allah knows best about that which He has sent down. يُنَزِّلْ, تَنزِيل. قَالُوا, they say, meaning the people, the mushrikeen, what is their response to this abrogation? إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُفْتَرٍ, that you, O Prophet ﷺ, are a fabricator. You are inventing this. You come up with something new, so you change it. بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, rather most of them do not know. قُلْ, say, نَزَّلَهُ, he has brought it down. Who? رُوحُ الْقُدُسِ, the pure spirit, meaning جِبْرِيل, مِنْ رَبِّكْ, from your Lord. How? بالحق, in truth. Why? ليثبت الذين آمنوا, in order to keep firm those people who believe. وهدن, it's a guidance. وبشرى, and a good news. للمسلمين, for those who submit. So again, in these verses, what is mentioned? In both of these verses, the fact that the Quran is تنزيل. ولقد نعلم أنهم يقولون إنما يعلمه بشر. Certainly we know that the people say that a human being teaches him, meaning this Quran. Allah says, lisan, the language, الَّذِي يُلْحِدُونَ إِلَيْهِ, which they refer to, is أَعْجَمِي. It is non-Arab. Meaning that man is non-Arab. The person about whom they're saying that he teaches Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, who is he? He's not an Arab. وَهَذَا لِسَانٌ عَرَبِيٌ مُبِينٌ, and this Quran, it is in a language. Which language? Arabi, Arabic. That is mubin. That is clear. So, again, it is emphasized in so many verses that the Quran is speech that He revealed. Tanzeel. So first of all, kalam, and then tanzeel, that He revealed through Jibreel to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this belief that Allah is the one who sent the Quran. Of course we believe in this, but should we affirm this belief regularly? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught Bara bin Azib that when you go to your bed at night, then perform wudu as you do for prayer. and then lie down on your right side, and then say, Allahumma aslamtu wajhi ilayk, wa fawwadtu amri ilayk, wa alja'tu dhahri ilayk, raghbatan wa rahbatan ilayk, la malja'a wa la manja minka illa ilayk, Allahumma amantu بكتابك الذي أنزلت وبنبيك الذي أرسلت. Oh Allah, I believe in the book that you sent, you revealed, and in the Prophet whom you sent. And the Prophet ﷺ said, make these your last words. Meaning don't say anything after this dua, then only sleep. So this is a belief that we must affirm repeatedly, over and over again. Because when you continue to remind yourself, this Quran is from Allah, it is my Lord's speech, it is His message, it is His command, then you continue to give it its due right. But when we forget it, that this Qur'an is from Allah, then it loses its importance and value. You know, then we say, yeah, Qur'an for every hand and every heart. Yes, it should be for everybody, except for me. Which is why we don't read it regularly and we don't recite it regularly, we don't reflect on it. I mean, think about it, any work of deen we're doing, In any capacity, we need to check ourselves. What is our connection with the Book of Allah? Because if we don't have a proper connection with the Book of Allah, then the work that we're doing, it lacks spirit. It's hollow. It's empty. Think about it. When we work at an institute, in any capacity, and the institute, the motto is, the mission is, what? Quran for all, in every hand and every heart. And we're coming every day, every other day, working here, and we don't even recite Quran ourselves. We don't even reflect on the Quran ourselves. We don't love the Quran. We don't reflect on its meanings. Then what kind of service is this? What kind of service is this then? So we really need to reflect on ourselves. What kind of work am I doing? What kind of connection do I have with the Book of Allah? الَّذِينَ آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابِ يَتْلُونَهُ حَقَّ تِلَاوَتِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ. And if you don't believe in something passionately yourself, you cannot pass it on. If you're not convinced yourself, you cannot give it to others. Isn't it? Why is it that some salespeople, they're so good at, you know, making their sales? Why? Because they're convinced, or they show at least that they're convinced. They're passionately talking about a particular product. That it has changed their life, and it has helped them so much. So they convince you that that's what you need as well. Just the other day somebody told me about how this person, you know, they went to this particular institute to study. And they were asked that, what made you come? They said that, I know of this person who, this is what they said, a total brat. Okay? This is how they described them. Extremely, you know, arrogant and rude and whatever, didn't care about anybody. Just into their own life, basically. Obsessed with themselves and just into their own life. And this person went to that institute for 1 year. And they completely changed. They said they completely changed. When I saw them after 1 year, you know, he's like, I knew that he went to the right place. So I wanted to go as well. That if they can change so drastically, then there's hope for me also. Then what is going on in this place is definitely good. So the best, you know, means of selling is who? Yourself. This is how you convince somebody. But if we don't have a connection with the Quran ourselves, and I'm talking about every single individual over here, if we don't love the Quran ourselves, if we don't care about the Quran ourselves, if we don't recite it, then how can we give it to others? How can we serve others? How can we passionately work for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What do you think drove the companions? What? It was the Book of Allah. Right? It was the verses of the Quran that were in their hearts. That kept them going on and on and on. and serve the deen. When the Prophet ﷺ, he was in the Battle of Ahzab. And you remember the Battle of Ahzab? How was it? Nerves. The Battle of Nerves. Right? Because enemy from everywhere. Inside, hypocrites. Behind, the Jews. Beyond the trenches, mushrikeen. Think about it. Enemy at every level. Within, behind, in front. Everywhere. And imagine if a city is completely blocked. I mean, there's no food coming in, going out, no business, nothing. The Prophet ﷺ, he said on the day of Ahzab, فَقَالَ So he said, اللَّهُمَّ مُنزِلَ الْكِتَابِ سَرِيعَ الْحِسَابِ اللَّهُمَّ هْزِمِ الْأَحْزَابِ اللَّهُمَّ هْزِمْهُمْ وَزَلْزِلْهُمْ Oh Allah, the one who revealed the book. You see what he mentioned over here? Oh Allah, you revealed the book. You sent this guidance, this powerful guidance, sari' al-hisab, swift in calling to account. O Allah, defeat the ahzab and shake them. So this is a belief that we need to remind ourselves of. And this is something that we need to say at times of need, you know, when we need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help.
She's wondering, what does that mean? You know, where did it come from? So, you know, you have to tell her, you know, it came down from Allah. So now she also knows that, you know, Allah is high above.
Yes.
So can I mean, I'm saying Allah's words are so precise, and also proves that it can only come from Allah.
Yes.
It's so precise.
Yes. It's so precise. It's so beautiful. It's so powerful. So powerful. That, you know, Surah At-Tur, one of the companions, what did he say? That I heard the Prophet ﷺ reciting these verses in Maghrib. He had come from Makkah to speak to him about the prisoners of war. And when he heard the first few verses of Surah At-Tur, he felt as though, you know, his heart would rip apart. And he knew that the Qur'an was haqq. So powerful. So when we believe that the Qur'an is Allah's speech, it is His speech. The Lord of the world, He spoke the Qur'an. He said this Qur'an. These are His words. How would we treat the Qur'an? How would we treat the Qur'an then? If we truly believed in this, and if we felt this, how would we treat it? Our attitude would change, right? We would have more respect, more love, more willing to accept it, every ayah of it, every command of it. It would hold a lot of importance to us. It would not just be a textbook for us. Because those who study the Qur'an, memorize it or study its meanings, it's sad. After some time, we start treating the Book of Allah as a textbook. The way we quote ayat and the way we write the meanings and the way we put the Qur'an in our bag or take it out or, you know, we study it as if it's an ordinary textbook. This is something we need to remember. Yes, we are studying the Book of Allah, but remember, it is His kalam.
But the intensity of the words, whom is it from? We don't try to explain to them. And that has to be done. It's like for children especially. We just tell them the Quran is being played. But why? Why is it so important?
And teaching children from a young age, you know, to respect the Book of Allah, to respect His kalam. Anyway, let's continue. Yes, Ali, you want to say?
My first word that you said, and people recorded. Their weddings, they recorded. What was the card, they recorded. And they go back to it often and they look at it and they view it and they're amazed and it's like they're really reliving their past. And I was just reflecting on this compared to, like you said, if you really reflect that this is the kalam of Allah, then really wouldn't you want to learn exactly what He said, what He meant? You would want to learn Arabic fluently. You would want to teach it to your children. You would want to memorize it. You wouldn't want to forget any word of it. I was even reflecting on the fact when you go for Hajj, how you're in a state of ihram. So, you know, inshallah, may Allah give us all tawfiq to memorize His kalam. But I was thinking it would actually put you in the state of ihram if you think about it, in the sense you will start thinking, these things are haram, I can't do it, these things are something I should do. Like, you know, it will have that kind of empowerment on you.
Yes.
Because even nowadays, like if you look at the gems that are found in the earth, nobody can make it.
the value is so great, they preserve it in the museums. Or like a very wealthy person will buy it and they'll wear it with their best clothes in the best party, in the best form. Like they wouldn't just wear it on dirty clothes and like, you know, having not taken a shower. So how do we treat, like how do we recite the Quran? How do we treat others who are reciting Quran? And even the person who dies, if there's multiple people who died, we studied that the face, the person who will be entered first facing the right side will be the Hafiz. So now, like, everything now that you're mentioning, all these details, all the, you know, like, the blessings with it.
It makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Why the Qur'an is so important. Why is there so much fadila, virtue attached to memorizing the Qur'an and learning the Qur'an and reciting the Qur'an? Why so much reward and emphasis? Because it is Kalam al-Rahman. It is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next, number 23, isbatu, affirmation of ru'yati, seeing. Of who? Al-mu'mineen, the believers, meaning the believers seeing, looking at who? Rabbahum, their Lord. When? Yawm al-qiyamah, on the Day of Judgment. The proof that the believers will see their Lord on the Day of Judgment. They will see Him, they will see His beautiful face. وَقَوْلِهِ and His statement, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. Some faces that day will be نَاظِرَةٌ, radiant, happy. Why? Because إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. They will be looking at their Lord. On the Day of Judgment, some people, their faces will become beautiful. Why? Because إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. Because they will be looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring such happiness, such content, such relief, and such joy that their faces will transform. Their faces will become beautiful. And this is very natural. That when you're happy inside, you're content inside, you know, you have something to feel very, very happy about, instantly that happiness is expressed on your face. And it turns into beauty. It beautifies the face. Happiness beautifies the face. Sadness, anger, hatred, jealousy, what does that do to the face? Makes it ugly. Makes it ugly. إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. This is why, at another place in the Quran, Allah says, فَوَقَاهُمُ اللَّهُ شَرَّ ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ وَلَقَّاهُمْ نَضْرَةً وَسُرُورًا. نَضْرَة, beauty on the faces. سُرُورًا, happiness and joy in the heart. Seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring these two things, joy in the heart and beauty on the face. And notice how وُجُوه will be نَاظِرَة and وُجُوه إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَة. The faces will be looking. When you're looking at something with your face, what does it mean? That your face is turned towards it, right? And obviously, what is it on your face with which you see? Your eyes. So this is ru'ya, that is haqiqi. Really, in reality, actually. And there's no doubt about this. Believers will actually, truly see their Lord. Because it's seeing with the face, meaning seeing with the eyes. There's another kind of seeing which is with the heart. But that is tadabbur, that is tafakkur. This is looking with the eyes in reality. And there's no doubt about this because the Quran mentions it and there's so many ahadiths that prove this also. Next ayah, عَلَى الْأَرَائِكِ يَنْظُرُونَ. Upon the couches, they'll be looking. Meaning, Ahlul Jannah. They'll be sitting, reclining on their couches, on their seats, and they'll be looking. Looking at what? That is not mentioned. But, عَلَى الْأَرَائِكِ يَنْظُرُونَ. They're sitting and just looking and looking and looking. What does it show? That they're looking for a very long time. What is it that you can look at for a very long time? Or that you can look at again and again? You don't get tired of looking. Something that pleases you. Something that brings you joy, which is why some people will watch a movie once and then twice and then again and again and again. And you wonder, haven't you seen it already? Why do you need to see it again? What's the answer? I like it. For you, it's a big waste of time. 2 hours in a movie?
And if you've seen it 3 times, that means you've spent 6 hours of your life watching this stuff. And if you've seen it 4 times, you've spent 8 hours of your life watching this stuff. But for them, it's not a waste of time. Why? They like it. They love it. What you love, what you like, what brings you joy, you don't get tired of looking at it. Something that makes you glad, you don't get tired of looking at it. So in Jannah, and even on the Day of Judgment, the believers will look at many things that will bring them joy. From Jannah to their reward, to one another. And the greatest of all sights will be looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The greatest and most delightful sight. عَلَى الْأَرَائِكِ يَنْظُرُونَ. And remember that on the Day of Judgment, in the hereafter, just like every other ability or capacity of a human being, vision will also become very, very strong. We learned that a person will be able to see as far as 2,000 miles. Think about it. I mean, here in this world, for a person to look at something that is even 2 inches away, you know, because of their weakness in their vision, it's difficult. 2 feet away, it becomes difficult. They need their glasses. 2,000 miles away, even if something is as far as that, it will be easy for them to look at. This is what, because, and once a person enters Jannah, there's no work. Right? So a person can literally stop and look at and admire something for years and years and years. Years and years and years. You know how in this life what happens? You look at something, you like it, and you want to look at it, but you know that you have to do something else. You want to keep looking at your children or at some babies, but you're like, oh, I'm going to give them an evil eye, a better look away. Huh? You have this feeling, right? But in Jannah, على الأرائك ينظرون. Looking, looking, looking. And look, they can look far, far away. So they can look as far as 2,000 miles even. Why so much strength? Why will a person be given so much strength in the hereafter? So that the capacity to enjoy increases. Because with these eyes, how much can you enjoy? You stare at something for 5 minutes, your eyes start to burn. You're awake all day long. You need to close your eyes, even for a few minutes, in order to rest them. But in Jannah, this capacity will increase. Why? So that you can enjoy more. And the greatest of all delights is to be able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Musa alayhi salam, when he asked Allah, Rabbi arini anzur ilayk, I really, really want to see you. I can hear you, but I want to see you also. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Lan tarani. You can never see me. Meaning, with this body that you have, the life that you're living right now, it's beyond you. You don't have the capacity to see me. But in the hereafter, on the Day of Judgment, people will be given the capacity, the ability to see Allah Jalla Jalaluhu. The next ayah, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا. For those who do ihsan, for them is al-husna wa ziyada. For them is the most excellent reward. And that's not all. Wa ziyada, and even more. This ladha, this pleasure, this greatest delight is for who? Being able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is for who? Everybody? لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا. Those who do ihsan. So if we want to have the privilege of seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let's increase in our ihsan. In our words, in our actions, in our dealings. The more a person does ihsan, the more deserving he will be of seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the less a person does ihsan, the less worthy he is of this honor. For those who do ihsan is husna wa ziyada, and even more. What is even more? What does ziyada refer to? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained this as seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because seeing Allah is a privilege that will be given in addition to the favors in Jannah. Notice how seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not included in al-husna. It has been mentioned separately. Al-husna refers to all the pleasures in Jannah. all the rewards in Jannah, from the houses to the rivers to the family and the beauty and the vastness and the pleasures. Every single enjoyment of Jannah is included in Al-Husna. But seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is ziyada. Extra. Right? Because it is the greatest of all rewards. The greatest of all privileges. The greatest. Which is why when the people of Jannah will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they'll forget about everything. And you wonder sometimes, how can you forget about some delicious food that you've had or the most amazing experience that you have? How can you forget that? You can only forget it when what you experience next is even better. Even better. And also, the favors in Jannah, they are all to do with the body. Isn't it? Food and drink and clothes and jewelry. Right? And rivers and companions. All of that is what? Bodily pleasures, right? But seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is the comfort of the heart. That's the enjoyment of the heart. Ziyada. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا. For them, they will have whatever they want in Jannah. The people of Jannah will have in Jannah anything that they could desire. More than what they could desire even. Because the last person to enter Jannah, and you know how he will enter Jannah, right? He will be taken out of the hellfire, he will be facing hellfire. After some time he will say, Ya Allah, please turn my face away from hellfire. It's heat, you know, it's killing me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will turn his face away from hellfire. So he'll be looking at Jannah, and the person will say, I promise I won't ask you anything. And then he will look at Jannah from far, just the doors of Jannah, just the opening, and he will wait for some time and he will say, Ya Allah, can I please go a little closer to Jannah? And Allah will remind him of all the promises that he made. And Allah will say to him that if I give this to you, will you ask me of anything again? And he will say, no, promise. I won't ask you of anything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will draw him close to Jannah. Same thing will happen. He will stay for some time and then he will say, please, can I go in? Can I just go to the door? Can I just go in? And eventually the person will be admitted into Jannah. And when he will be admitted, Allah will say, ask, what do you want? So a person will ask and ask and ask and ask and ask. And then Allah will say, ask for more. He will ask for more and more and more and more. Until that person will run out of his wishes, his wish list. You know, his wish list is exhausted. Any possible reward that he can imagine, it's all done. Everything he's given. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remind him, what about this? Don't you want this? What about that? Don't you want that? Don't you want this? Don't you want that? And Allah will keep giving him and giving him and giving him. And Allah will say, and you will have mithlahu ma'ahu. Meaning twice as much as this. And another sahabi, he said, no, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, 10 times it's like. All of these enjoyments, just imagine. Any enjoyment that a person can imagine. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا. More than a person can even desire, he will find in Jannah. But you know what? وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيد. And with us is even more. Even more. And what is mazid? The privilege to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Such a great Lord. And yet, He will give His insignificant creation the chance to see Him, the chance to meet Him, the chance to converse with Him. But at the same time, there are those who will be concealed, who will not be allowed to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كَلَّا إِنَّهُمْ عَنْ رَبِّهِمْ يَوْمَ إِذِلَّ لَمَحْجُوبُونَ. Nay, indeed, they will be from their Lord on that day concealed. There will be a barrier between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those whom He is pleased with, He will show Himself to them. And those that He is angry with, He is upset with, He will not show Himself to them. They will be distanced from Allah, far, far from Him. لَمَحْجُوبُونَ. Concealed. وَهَذَا الْبَابِ. And this topic, meaning the topic of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His hearing to His seeing to the believers being able to see Him, all of these attributes, Ibn Taymiyyah says, they are fi kitabillah, they are in the book of Allah kathir, abundantly. Meaning there is abundant mention of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the book of Allah. You don't need to go any further than the book of Allah. Once you open the book of Allah, almost every ayah tells you about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His name, His attribute, His action, His command, His wish, His will, His like, His dislike. Almost every ayah of the Quran tells us about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَن تَدَبَّرَ الْقُرْآنِ And whoever reflects upon the Quran, طَالِبًا seeking لِلْهُدَى for guidance, minhu from it, meaning whoever reflects on the Quran, seeking guidance from the Quran, تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ طَرِيقُ الْحَقِّ The correct way will become evident to him, meaning he will definitely find this truth. He will definitely find the right guidance. But notice over here, it's not just someone who reads the Quran who will find the truth, because there are many, many people who read the Quran. It is the one who reflects on the Quran, first of all. Tadabbara, reflection. Not just reading, but reflection. Not just studying and memorizing, but reflection. And this means that when we recite the Quran, yes, our focus should be on the correct pronunciation of the words, applying the rules of tajweed. Yes, our, you know, focus should be on the meaning, on the lessons that we can derive, but our focus must also be on who? Allah. Because this is His speech. This has come from Him. And how is it possible that a person is reading the Quran but he's not thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Does not find in the Quran something that will give him a better understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That will make him love Allah more and fear Allah more and draw close to Allah. Reflection on the Quran. So when we recite the Quran, really our focus should be on what? Allah's attributes. Allah's attributes. Many times at the end of verses we learn about Allah's names and attributes. And we just say them and we pass on. We read them and we move on. Allah is telling us about His name, about His attribute, about His action. Wait a little bit. Focus on that. Establish the connection between the name and the message that is given in the ayah, between the attribute and the action that is mentioned. Reflect on that. مَن تَدَبَّرَ الْقُرْآنَ طَالِبًا لِلْهُدَى The second condition is طَالِبًا لِلْهُدَى Read with the intention of seeking guidance. Not just increasing in information, looking for proof, seeking evidence. Yeah, okay, that's also good. However, our first and foremost reason for reading the Qur'an should be seeking guidance. طَالِبًا لِلْهُدَى And the one who will do this, تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ طَرِيقُ الْحَقِّ The correct way will become clear to him. How is it that a person can find guidance? Reflection and good intention. Reflection and good intention. Reflection as in pay attention. Pause, reflect, think about it. Don't rush. And secondly, a good intention. Not to show off, not to find a proof with which we can negate somebody. No, a good intention. I want to draw closer to my Lord. I want to better understand this concept. And any person who will reflect on the Quran like this, he will definitely see the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's amazing how all of these verses, if you think about it, we've studied them before, right? But look at how to, you know, under one topic, on the same theme, Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, you know, as if he has, you know, literally plucked so many beautiful fruits and flowers as evidence as he's brought them before us. They were known to us before. We knew about these ayat. But the way they're presented here, one after the other, one after the other, one after the other, you know, portions of ayat, or ayat, you know, complete ayat, they clarify the right way.
The more you communicate to a person, to a being whom you haven't met, you want to meet and see. So, you know, after this kalam and everything, then he brings the ru'yah, because there's this very deep connection. You want to see somebody that you've been talking to or listening to for a long time.
Yes. You've loved, you've admired, you feared. You know that they know you and they've seen you and they've protected you and they've helped you do anything in your life. Then you want to meet them, you want to see them.
Singing and everything he will give us in Jannah to the mu'mineen, even those are makhluk of Allah. He created them, but this is the kalam of Allah. I mean, it's another level. It's a totally different thing other than makhluk of Allah.
The next section is al-istidlalu ala athbati asma'illahi wa sifatihi min as-sunnah. So, taking proof of affirmation of Allah's names and attributes from the sunnah. Because the first is that we look at the Qur'an, what does the Qur'an say, and then we look at the sunnah. What does the sunnah say? So alhamdulillah, we have completed one section of the book, alhamdulillah, in which we have studied the various proofs and evidences that we learn from the Qur'an with respect to the names and attributes of Allah. Now inshallah, as you recite the Qur'an, what is it that we're going to look at? Allah's names and attributes, His mention, where He is being mentioned, how He is being mentioned, what do we learn about that? You know, we read huwa, He is, right? Or, you know, in a verb, we know that, okay, it's referring to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't just pass on. Reflect on that. This is about Allah. And get to know your Lord better. Because this knowledge is the first step to a stronger, a better connection. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته